Hello my dear students, in this video I will discuss about the topic shoulder dystocia. Dystocia means the abnormal or the difficult labor. So what is shoulder dystocia? When there is a failure of the spontaneous delivery of the shoulders. Spontaneous means by its own, and the additional maneuvers required to deliver the shoulders. First of all, its definition. The term shoulder dystocia is defined to describe a wide range of difficulties, means the lot of difficulties which encountered or experienced during the delivery of the shoulders. As you can see in this diagram, it occurs when either the anterior or the posterior fetal shoulder impacts or stuck either behind the maternal symphysis or on the sacral premotory. As you can see in this diagram, here the anterior shoulder is impact or stuck behind the, this is a symphysis pubis, so stuck behind the symphysis pubis. And the impaction of posterior fetal shoulder occurs rarely, very rarely, which impacts on the sacral premotory. And shoulder dystocia is also defined as a prolonged head to body delivery time, which is more than 60 seconds, is referred or called as shoulder dystocia. Next is the incidence. The incidence rate of shoulder dystocia varies between 0.2 and 1% among all the deliveries. Next is the predisposing factors of shoulder dystocia. Under this, first one is fetal macrosomia. Next is obesity, diabetes, mid-pelvic instrumental delivery, post-maturity, multiparity, anencephaly, and fetal ascites. I will discuss all these factors one by one in detail. First one is fetal macrosomia. It is a condition when the fetus is much more larger than the normal, or when the weight of the fetus is more than 4000 gram. And in that case, when the fetus is much more larger, there are the chances of impaction or the stucking of the shoulder during vaginal delivery. An impaction or the stucking of the shoulder is a condition which is known as shoulder dystocia. Next cause or factor is obesity. If the mother is obese, there are the chances of fetal macrosomia, which as a result cause shoulder dystocia. Or there is a second possibility. If the mother is obese, there are the chances of developing gestational diabetes among the obese mothers. And that gestational diabetes also cause fetal macrosomia. And how the gestational diabetes cause fetal macrosomia, that I will discuss in next factor. Next factor is diabetes, or we can also say the gestational diabetes. How it causes shoulder dystocia? In this case, the higher amount of blood glucose level passes from the placenta to the fetal circulation, and that extra glucose stored in the fetus as a body fat, and as a result fetal macrosomia occurs, which causes shoulder dystocia. And gestational diabetes is also characterized by the larger shoulders, and because of larger shoulders there are the chances of impaction of shoulder, which is known as shoulder dystocia. Next factor is a mid-pelvic instrumental delivery, or we can also say the mid-pelvic forceps delivery or mid-pelvic vacuum delivery. After the prolonged second stage, that when there is a full dilatation of the cervix but the head of the fetus is present midway through the maternal pelvis. In that case, mid-pelvic instrumental delivery can be done, which as a result might cause shoulder dystocia. That is, in the 75% of cases of mid-pelvic instrumental delivery might develop shoulder dystocia. Next factor is multiparous woman, the woman who is pregnant for more than one time. In the multiparous woman, there are the more chances of larger babies, and as a result the shoulder dystocia might occur. And in the multiparous woman, there are the more chances of precipitate labor during the second stage of labor, which takes less than 15 minutes to deliver the baby. And as a result, it might cause shoulder dystocia. Next factor is anencephaly. This is a congenital disorder when the brain and the fetal skull is not properly formed. In that case, the size of the head is less, and because of this diminished head size, the cervix is not properly or not enough dilate to deliver the fetal trunk and the shoulders, and as a result it causes shoulder dystocia. Next factor is fetal ascites. When there is a fluid accumulation in the fetal abdomen which might cause arrest, and as a result dystocia occurs. Next are the complications which occurs due to the shoulder dystocia. There are fetal complications as well as maternal complications. First one is asphyxia under fetal complication. This is a condition when there is a deficit level of oxygen in the body due to the abnormal respiration. As the shoulders of the baby is stuck, and because of which the baby is unable to breathe, or baby can't breathe, and sometimes the umbilical cord is also squeezed, because of which the level of oxygen is decreased in the body, which is known as asphyxia or asphyxiation. The next complications is brachial plexus injury. What are brachial plexus? These are the network of nerves which provide the signals from the spinal cord to the shoulder, arm and hand. And how the brachial plexus injury occur? As in the case of shoulder dystocia, the shoulder is impacted behind the symphysis pubis, impacted or stuck. So the nerves, brachial plexus, are stretched, or the network of nerves are stretched. And because of these stretching, the injury occurs to the nerves, which is also known as plexopathy. Next is Erb's palsy. And due to the injury to the nerves, the paralysis of arm occur, which is known as Erb's palsy. Next is Lemke palsy. In this, the lower arm and the hand is affected because of the injured nerves. Next is fracture humerus, clavicle or sternomastoid hematoma during delivery. In the shoulder dystocia, the humerus is fractured. There are the chances of fracture of humerus and clavicle. This is a long bone of upper arm, humerus, and the clavicle is the collarbone, or which is also known as beauty bones. Next is sternomastoid hematoma. Sternomastoid, this is a long muscle which connects the sternum, clavicle and the mastoid process of the temporal bone. And when the tiny capillaries leak or torn, the blood comes out of the blood vessels and accumulated. That is known as hematoma. And when the blood is accumulated in this long muscle, that is known as sternocleidomastoid hematoma, which occurs during the delivery. Next is perinatal mortality and morbidity rate is high. Morbidity, that is the death and the disease rate is high. Next are the maternal complications. Under maternal complications, the first one is PPH, that is postpartum hemorrhage, the bleeding which occurs after the delivery of the baby. As in the case of shoulder dystocia, the cause behind the shoulder dystocia is fetal macrosomia. And when there is a fetal macrosomia and when there is a shoulder dystocia, the uterus is over distended, which might be the cause for the postpartum hemorrhage. And there are cervical, vaginal and perineal tears occur because of the overstretching of the birth canal, that might also cause bleeding. And sometimes these tears are so severe that the surgical correction of these tears might be needed. Next is the increased operative delivery and morbidity. Next are the diagnosis of shoulder dystocia, that how we can diagnose this shoulder dystocia. Under this, first one is turtleneck sign. What is turtleneck sign? In this, the baby's head first come out of the birth canal and the neck is visible. But if there is a shoulder dystocia, then the baby's head slightly goes back into the birth canal and here the neck is not visible. That is known as turtleneck sign. And why it is known as turtleneck sign? Because like turtle, as the turtle's head comes out of its shell and then again goes back into its shell. So like turtle, the baby's head moves, so that's why it is known as turtleneck sign. Next is inadequate spontaneous restitution, means improper restitution by its own. What is restitution? This is a rotation of the baby's head back to relieve the torsion. But if the restitution is not occur by its own, then the baby's head remain in that position, that is occipital anterior position, even after the delivery of the head with the extension. Next diagnosis that is fetal face become plethoric. What is plethoric? That is red in color. The fetus face become red. Why it becomes red? Because of the swelling of the blood vessels. Next are the management principles. If the shoulder dystocia occurs, then call for the extra help and clear the infant's mouth and nose for the secretions. Not to give traction over the baby's head, means do not pull the baby's head. Next is never to apply fundal pressure. Okay, so not to give traction over the baby's head, as if we pull the baby's head, it causes brachial plexus injury. Which results in paralysis. So that's why the pull should be avoided. Next is never to apply fundal pressure, as it causes further impaction. If we apply pressure over the fundus, it will cause further stucking of the shoulder. So that's why it should not be done. Next is to perform wide mediolateral episiotomy, means cut over the perineum, as it provides space posteriorly. And this mediolateral episiotomy does not resolve the shoulder dystocia, but it helps for the additional maneuvers and it provides the space for performing additional maneuvers. Next is to involve anesthetist and the pediatrician. Anesthetist for providing the anesthesia to the mother and pediatrician for infant resuscitation. Next is the management of shoulder dystocia. Under management, there are certain maneuvers which are performed to deliver the shoulders. The first maneuver is, this is a rough diagram which I draw. In the first maneuver, grasp the head and the neck with both the hands and taken it posteriorly. And there should be one assistant who applies the pressure over the suprapubic region. This is a symphysis pubis and the area above the symphysis pubis, that is suprapubic region. And one assistant should have to apply the pressure over the suprapubic region so that the impacted shoulder or the stuck shoulder should be released. And the pressure which is applied over the suprapubic region, that pressure should be applied slightly towards the fetal chest, so as to rotate the anterior shoulder towards the oblique diameter, so that the bisacromial diameter, that is the diameter between the distance between the two shoulders, is reduced, so that the shoulders can easily deliver. This is one of the simplest maneuver and effective also. Head and neck should be grasped and taken posteriorly, while suprapubic pressure is applied by an assistant slightly towards the side of the fetal chest. Next is McRoberts maneuver. In this, two things are done. First one is the maternal thighs are flexed on the abdomen, and when the maternal thighs are flexed on the abdomen, the symphysis pubis moves upward, and it will not increase the diameters of the pelvis, but it straightens the sacrum as compared to the lumbar, which helps in the delivery of the shoulders. And the next thing is applying suprapubic pressure that can help to release the stuck or impacted shoulder. Applying suprapubic pressure can help to dislodge the anterior fetal shoulder. The next maneuver is Woods maneuver. Before performing this maneuver, firstly administer the general anesthesia. In this maneuver, two fingers are inserted in the posterior vagina, and simultaneously a pressure should be applied on the suprapubic region, that is above the symphysis pubis, not here. And with these two fingers, rotate the shoulders from the anterior posterior diameter to the oblique diameter, so that the bisacromial diameter, that is the diameter or the distance between the two shoulders, is easily enters into the pelvic inlet and delivered. Next maneuver is extraction of posterior arm, and before performing this maneuver, the general anesthesia should be administered. In this maneuver, the hand is introduced along with the humerus of the posterior arm, and then slightly move the arm towards the chest, and then with the gentle traction or with the gentle pull, the arm, posterior arm, should be delivered. And the other techniques, if these all maneuvers are failed, then the other techniques should be used. In this, the first one is cleidotomy. In this, either the one or both the clavicle bones are cut with the help of scissor, so that the shoulder girth should be reduced. And this procedure mainly done in the case of dead fetus or the live fetus with an anencephaly. And the next is Giovanelli's maneuver. In this, the fetus head is, or the baby's head is, pushed back into the uterus, and then cesarean section should be done. And the last one is symphysiotomy. In this, the symphysis pubis is cut so as to deliver the shoulders, and this procedure is very rarely done. And that's all about the management of the shoulder dystocia. My dear students, I hope you all are clear with this topic, but if you have any kind of query, then please ask me in the comment section. And if you find my videos useful, then please like my videos. And if you are new at my channel, then please subscribe my channel.